Okay, everybody, and welcome, and thanks for coming to this optional session on Brexit, though I guess we're all a bit fed up with prefixes, with we're feeling Brexitian by now, but but still, we thought it would be useful to have a session, an interactive session, where we talk a little bit about the implications of the referendum on the 23rd of June, and to have some kind of structured, both law and broader policy discussion on what this means, what might happen, what are the legal requirements, but also what are the broader implications for the EU and the UK of the vote on the 23rd of June. So the way we're going to structure the discussion is we're going to start off by having a look at the famous Article 50. And Bruno is going to say a few words about how this might be read. And then we will have a Q&A. So any further points people want to raise on that particular issue and discussion, we will take it as we go along. After that, we will talk about if the UK does notify under Article 50 that it wishes to withdraw, what sort of exit options does it have? And Maurice will very briefly open the discussion on that, and then we'll have a broader discussion, questions from you. Innovative solutions are welcome, if anybody has any. And after that, we will discuss whether there are options for the UK to remain in the EU and how that might happen. So those are the three segments of this afternoon's discussion. And we really welcome your thoughts. And I'm going to hand the floor to Bruno to kick us off by saying something about Article 50.
Thank you, Claire. There's one thing on which everybody seems to agree, only one thing, and that is that Article 50 provides for the procedure for withdrawal of the UK. That's at least something, no? That there seems to be no controversy on that point. So this is the route, the channel through which the UK could decide to leave the European Union. It's interesting to see that because As most of you know, this is an article which was added to the treaties only very recently through the Treaty of Lisbon. It's an invention actually of the Constitutional Convention, Convention on the Constitution of Europe, which came up with this new article, and then it was replicated in the Lisbon Treaty. Before that, there's been, before Lisbon, there had been some controversies in the literature whether it was at all possible for a state to leave the European Union once it had entered it. And some diehard European federalists actually denied it, said, once you enter, that's forever. No, you can never change, leave the EU. But the practice, I think, the practice of the member states was to the contrary. And the piece of practice that is relevant here was, of course, the first referendum on UK membership, which was taken in 1975, a few years after the UK had joined the communities. The UK organized a referendum on whether people wanted to stay. And as far as I know, none of the other member states at the time protested against it. None of the other member states argued, you cannot do this. No, once you're in, you stay in. Everybody accepted that it was a possibility for the United Kingdom at that time to leave the EU. So I think that from the perspective of the member states, there was always the understanding that states could leave the EU. Now, the advantage of Article 50 is that it provides for a procedure. And I think in the absence of it, we would have had even more controversies today. So at least it's marginally useful to have that article because it sets the scene for what might happen. So what is, I think, most relevant in the text of this article? The first thing that is relevant is obviously that the initiative is taken by the member state that wants to leave. So as you know, that immediately after the referendum, some leaders of EU institutions or of governments said the UK must now immediately notify. They have to. There's a legal obligation. It's not true. There is no legal obligation. Okay, it's entirely free. So states are entirely free to decide at some point of time to express the wish to withdraw. How do they do that? It's written in the first line of paragraph 2. A member state which decides to withdraw shall notify the European Council of its intention. So this notification is the starting point of the negotiations on withdrawal. And the treaty doesn't say when such a notification must be given, since it is within the free discretion of the member state concerned. And so as we know now, one of the discussions taking place in the UK essentially is when should this notification be given? And the tendency seems to be to want to wait as long as possible, or at least until the end of this year, or perhaps even early next year. And the reasons for that is something we will come back to in the discussion, but also it's also related to one of the clauses in Article 50, to which I'll come back. So the notification is given to the European Council, and then what you get is a negotiation, interestingly, between the Union and the state concerned. I find that a bit odd because, as you know, in order to become a member, in order to accede to the European Union, what you need is a treaty between the old member states and the new member state. So the EU as an organization is not involved, legally speaking, in accession of new states. When states leave, it's different. So it's not the other member states who make an agreement with the UK in this case, it's the EU itself. It's the EU that is negotiating. You could say on behalf of the states. But at the end of the day, as you see at the very end of paragraph 2, the decision on the European side to agree on the withdrawal agreement is taken by qualified majority. So there is not even a veto right for single countries to oppose the agreement. Now, what is this agreement about, the agreement on withdrawal? The paragraph 2 says, the Union shall negotiate and conclude an agreement. So what is meant is an international treaty. There's no doubt about that. So a binding international treaty with that state, setting out the arrangements for its withdrawal, taking account of the framework for its future relationship with the Union. So you have two different things here. One thing is the arrangements linked to withdrawal, which are things like on which date will withdrawal take place, what will be the immediate consequences, for example, for the functioning of the institutions, for the British civil servants of the EU, so all the things that are immediately linked to membership, the budget, and so on. And then, but the treaty should also take into account the framework for the future relationship of that country with the Union. So the future relationship, which is the topic which Maurice will introduce later on, is not something that will be included within the withdrawal agreement, but it seems to presuppose here that there is already some discussion on it, that there is already some idea on what this future relationship will be. And I think that makes a lot of sense, because some people have said on the European side, oh, we will first negotiate withdrawal, and once that's done, once you're out, then we're going to start negotiating the new cooperation with the UK. That doesn't make much sense, no? I think it makes much more sense to at least have a clear idea of how the future relationship would look like before the actual withdrawal takes place. And in that respect, you shouldn't forget that the withdrawal agreement doesn't necessarily enter into force immediately. Okay, that's what you have with international treaties. A treaty can be agreed, signed, but it can have a clause saying it will enter into force only, you know, next year or in 2 years or in 3 years. So in this way, the withdrawal can be synchronized, if you want, with the agreement on future relationship between the EU and the UK. So in a sort of rational world, that is what should happen. We don't know whether it's going to happen, but at least it's very well possible to have the two negotiations going hand in hand, the negotiation on withdrawal itself and on the future relationship with the UK. So the last thing I want to say is the famous guillotine provision, the 2 years, the reference to the 2 years in paragraph 3. So it says that the treaties shall cease to apply to the state in question, either from the date of entry into force of the withdrawal agreement, or failing that, if there is no agreement, 2 years after the notification. So that's the guillotine. If a withdrawal is being notified, that sets the clock ticking. And if the UK and the European Union cannot come to an agreement within 2 years on the content of the withdrawal agreement, then withdrawal will nevertheless happen automatically after 2 years. And therefore, I think that's why people are hesitant, also on the UK side, on the Leave side, to start the process. Because once you notify, then the 2 years start ticking. So the interests expressed by some of the components of the Leave camp is to first sound out the other countries about the future relationship, to have the so-called informal negotiations on the future links between the UK and the EU. And if there is some reassurance there that there can be an interesting deal, an attractive deal, then the notification can take place. Because then there is some reassurance that a deal can be reached within 2 years' time. And obviously, there may be reasons then from the other sides, from the radical camp on the European side, to say the notification should happen immediately, because in this way, pressure is put on the United Kingdom. Because if no agreement is reached within 2 years, then the UK leaves entirely, and there's no links anymore with the European Union, and that is clearly not what most people would want, not to have to be in the position of Albania. That's the Albanian model, as some people have called, which is not true, because Albania has an association agreement with... So I prefer to call it the Belarus model. So, country which basically has no links at all with the European Union. That's the position in which the UK would find itself if there is no agreement at all, and if withdrawal happens automatically after 2 years. So that's all I wanted to say by way of introduction on the text of Article 50.
So thanks a lot, Bruno, for starting the discussion on that. I think we can already open up the issues relating just to what does Article 50 imply to the floor, and see if anyone's got some comments or interventions they want to make on that front.
Thank you very much. And already in 2010, Hannes Hofmeister wrote a piece criticizing the procedural framework for Article 50 as not detailed enough. And I think that's really been borne out in the chaos and uncertainty that's followed the vote 2 weeks ago. We're still not sure if the UK will actually invoke Article 50 and how it should happen. So my question is, in addition to whether we should have a more detailed framework, about whether as part of this framework there should be some form of legal condition which a member state has to fulfill in order to show why they no longer or can no longer participate in integration. For example, through providing evidence that their obligations within the European Union are preventing the ability to provide for the welfare of their own citizens. So almost like an impact assessment before triggering the article. Thank you.
Hi, I have two questions. First, do you know what was the intention behind those 2 years, the guillotine clause? I mean, that seems rather arbitrary in thinking about the case of Greenland, which kind of withdrew, you know, with the connections to Denmark. I think that took way more than 2 years and was mostly concerned with fisheries and something like that. And also, second question, do you think the treaty allows for a withdrawal from the withdrawal, like the UK, once Article 50 is employed, could pull out? And also maybe one quick comment, which links to what we heard by Mr. Walker. You noted the aspects or the role of informality when developing new policy, fields of policy, or furthering integration, and now we have seen the strong opposition to any informality before Article 50, the formal procedure, is introduced. So this is kind of, you know, the fear of informality taking ways we don't know exactly where they take us.
Yeah, I was actually wondering why they choose for a qualified majority and not for a veto, for example, because it's enormous. Actually, it has an enormous impact on the European Union, and it's so important. So why do you not choose for a veto? And why did you choose for a majority?
Yes, please. I would like to know your perspective from the international law of the treaties, which exercise we can do between the two regimes.
Another question? Just, I mean, I wouldn't want to try and respond to all of those, but just to make perhaps one point that covers a few of the points that were being made. I think the idea of what's behind quite a number of these rules, including the two-year cutoff, also the QMV, is that the idea of Article 50 was to allow a member state to withdraw. I mean, Bruno was making that point at the beginning. So some of these rules are designed to ensure that the other member states can't block a member state who wants to withdraw. And it's a little bit ironic now, because they're now being seen as constraints on the state that wants to withdraw. You know, oh, we've only got 2 years, and that puts us under pressure. But the idea was that the member state who wanted to withdraw, that the other member states could not block it by spinning out the negotiations, by refusing to agree the withdrawal agreement. So, you know, if the withdrawal agreement is not agreed within 2 years, then we can go anyway, you know? This was the conception behind it. But of course, now it might be seen as a straitjacket. And it's the same with the QMV. I think that the idea was precisely that, and it's interesting, isn't it? Because in order for a state to become a member of the EU, All the member states, existing member states, have to agree. But for a state to withdraw, they don't. So it's easier to withdraw in that sense than it is to become a member. And that's a reflection of this idea that it's underlining the liberty of a state to be able to withdraw. And for that reason, it seems to me the whole tenor of the article is in favor of allowing a withdrawal from withdrawal. So, in other words, I don't think that the other member states, the other 27, could block a member state that decided to withdraw its notification. Let's put it that way, to withdraw its notification under Article 50, because the rationale behind the framework of Article 50 is giving the decision to the withdrawing member state to insist on withdrawal, but then also, I think, to pull back if they decide to do that. That would be my take on it.
On the last point, I fully agree with Maryse, and I think the argument for why withdrawal from withdrawal is allowed can be reinforced also by invoking the international law of treaties. Because I think it is what happens here in this context is that a treaty is being negotiated, and therefore the international law of treaties will apply to that. So to the extent that you don't have specific rules in Article 50, all the other rules that apply will come from international law. And one of them, from an international law perspective, what you have here with the notification of withdrawal is a unilateral action by a state. And as long as there is no agreement, that is to say, as long as other states have not acquired rights and obligations through an agreement, they cannot stop that country from withdrawing its unilateral declaration. So as long as the negotiation is going on for this agreement on withdrawal, there's no obligations. I think there's bona fide obligations, you know, to conduct the negotiations in a proper way, but there's no obligation to continue the negotiations. We see many examples, of course, in international relations of countries starting to negotiate an agreement and then stopping when they see that they cannot come to an agreement which is in their interest. So if the UK at some point thinks it's no longer in our interest to withdraw, they will say, we stop here. We don't continue negotiations, and we withdraw our early notification. There was one thing I wanted to add that to this. The first comment on whether the regime is too rough, let's say, you know, whether one should have added more conditions to withdrawal. I think that deliberate choice was made to limit the article to procedure. It's all about procedure and nothing on substance. So there's not a single word about reasons why countries should withdraw or reasons why they should not be allowed to withdraw, et cetera, et cetera. I think it was a deliberate choice, which I think is reasonable, because if you start doing this, you get into endless discussions, of course. So I think it's better to say, okay, this is a procedure, and we assume that countries will not lightheartedly make use of this procedure, that they will think carefully before they engage in it. And that's, of course, not sure whether that is really true, what's going to happen. But I think that was the idea. We simply provide a procedure, and then, you know, the grown-ups will then use it.
I mean, the only qualification to that is, I mean, an element of the procedure is the member states' own constitutional requirements. And this, it underlines the point I was making about the mm-hmm. fact that it is the member state that is in the driving seat in that sense, but also that the constitutional requirements of that member state may themselves have substantive elements to them. I mean, they don't have to, though, and EU law doesn't say that they have to. Okay. Do you want to come?
I mean, the member states' constitutional requirements actually come in twice, though. Mm-hmm. They come in at the point of deciding to withdraw. So presumably, for these purposes, the only relevant constitutional requirement is following the terms of the 2015 Referendum Act. But then, of course,
it doesn't say anything.
It says nothing about the final stages of the ratification of the treaty, where it's implicit that the constitutional requirements have to be gone through again. But can I just say, I mean, one thing about this question about withdrawing the withdrawal is that everyone's thinking about it, but no one can talk about it. Yeah. You know, obviously, European institutions can't talk about it, because that, in a sense, would be to encourage the possibility of it happening. And clearly, the Leave people who will be running the British government over the next couple of years can't talk about it either. So, in a sense, it's the unspoken shadow underneath this. Also, the 2 years, one point on the 2 years, someone made the point that compared to the Greenland example, you know, it doesn't seem very long. But of course, I actually think that part of it is reasonably well drafted, because what it is, it's like a kind of link in a chain. It says that you have to link this to the framework for the agreement to follow, but you do not have to specify the terms of all these agreements. So in a sense, you can't just close it off like a raw wound. You have to say we have the beginnings of a continuity agreement, but only the beginnings of it. So the alternatives to that would be to say there's no relationship to the future, which is some of the European people have been saying, which I think would be wrong, or to say that everything has to be resolved, which would be equally wrong, because then there'd be no limit to it. So actually, there I think they have they've done a reasonably good job.
I think the other point is also that there is quite a lot of power built in for the union through that two-year period, the fact that it can only be prolonged, that any member state basically can veto the prolongation of that two-year period once it starts. You know, if there's no withdrawal from withdrawal, then that's what happens once it starts. And it's the European Council, my reading at least, is that it's the European Council that then decides, and that's the 27, that decides who, in a sense, will negotiate on behalf of the Union. So my reading, it's not necessarily the Commission. Normally, for international treaties, it would be the Commission, and then it would be concluded on behalf of the Union by the Council. But now we have the 27 deciding that. I also see there's no time limit. Like, we don't know, once the notification has taken place, the two-year period runs, but we don't know how much time it will take for the guidelines, the European Council to come up with setting the whole thing out and how far they will go with this important phrase, taking account of the framework for its future relationship with the Union, in paragraph two. So it seems to me as well, you know, once it's triggered, then there is quite a lot of both uncertainties but also discretion on the European side.
Can I add a little thing on the negotiation on the European side? As Deirdre says rightly, it's not quite clear who is going to lead the negotiations. The article refers to the procedure of Article 218, paragraph 3 on the TFEU, which is a procedure for the negotiation of external agreements of the EU. But it actually refers to two possible procedures, because it's in Article 218, paragraph 3, it says that either the Commission or the High Representative, depending on the subject matter, will lead the negotiations. So it's not very helpful to refer to Article 218, also because what we're talking about here is not an external agreement, okay? It's an agreement between the EU and one of its own member states. The UK is still a member state at this point. And there's not many examples of that. We have some examples of international treaties between the EU and one of its member states, but it's very rare. And you can understand why, no? Because the member state is in the EU. Why should it then have to conclude international treaties? But we have a few examples, mainly with Denmark. The EU has concluded a few treaties with Denmark to allow Denmark to participate in justice and home affairs, parts of justice and home affairs. And that is because of the way the protocol on Denmark is structured. That was the only legal way to allow Denmark to participate in some aspects of justice and home affairs. So they have to conclude an international treaty between the EU and one of its member states, which is really odd. And the same thing will happen here.
Yes, I mean, what the paragraph does is to say that the Council will nominate the negotiator or the head of the negotiating team. So it depends. It might be the Commission, or quite likely, I would imagine, there would be a member state, a council presence as well, or possibly high representative presence. Yeah.
Thank you. I just have a question on the reference to Article 218, paragraph 3, and on the role and the intervention of the European Council in the process of negotiation for withdrawal. So, since Article 218 indicates that it's the Council of the European Union to nominate the chief negotiator, but here the guidelines are provided by the European Council. So, how is this is this reference in Article 50 to be intended as integrally attributing the power to nominate the negotiator to the Council, or should it be like substituted by the European Council? And our second question is, are these guidelines by the European Council to be intended as the directive on negotiating directive on for the chief negotiator or not, or are they two different things? Thank you.
Thanks. I was wondering about the value of finality, because it seems to me that when you read the article, there is some kind of value to having certainty, both for the member state that is trying to withdraw and also for the other member states in knowing what is going to happen. So it's quite vague, but there seems to be some kind of recognition that a very long period of negotiations may be harmful. So I was wondering what you think about that.
Okay, well, just on the 218 question, I think that's really, really good question. And it's not easy, because as Bruno was saying, we have this slightly odd, we have this referencing of 218 paragraph 3, but then we also have the procedural elements in paragraph 2 of Article 50 as well about the agreement. So, or not only paragraph 2, but mainly. So it's not sort of totally easy to dovetail them together. So 218 paragraph C3 talks about the Commission or the High Representative recommending to the Council, which will adopt decisions or opening the authorization of negotiations. But it, and then in paragraph 2, it talks about in the light of the guidelines provided by the European Council. So there is an ambiguity there. My tendency, I mean, but this is just my, you know, my view, which is as good as anybody else's, would be to see the European Council guidelines as the equivalent of the negotiating directives, so that the European, because otherwise what are they and what are they for? So I think instead of as normal, the negotiating directives come from the Council, here the negotiating directives are essentially coming from the European Council. But I don't think that means, I still, in order for that reference to 218 paragraph 3 to mean anything at all, it must mean that it's the Council that then sets up the negotiating team, because otherwise there's nothing left of 218 paragraph 3 to mean anything. So I that's how I would sort of balance those two provisions, but it's very, that's just my reading of it, let's put it that way.
I can just maybe come in on Miriam's point. I mean, I wonder, is it really that Article 50 is vague, or are we actually just looking at the consequences of the unexpected consequences of what has happened in the light of the result in the referendum? So, as has been said, I think, by Maurice, especially, it was expected that a state would decide, okay, we want to leave, off we go. Whereas instead, what we got was first the immediate delinking by David Cameron on the 24th of June of the referendum result from the notification. So this was absolutely not what people thought was going to happen in relation to high articles. So is that not the main source of vagueness and uncertainty? Then we have also interventions that also don't seem really in the spirit of Article 50's wording, from EU officials, other EU politicians saying, you must withdraw straight away, but that is also not at all what Article 50 says. But I think it does open a question that we didn't really expect perhaps to have to face, but which is very much something we need to think about. What are the costs and benefits of a long period, a very long period before this notification may occur? And I don't think that's the fault of Article 50. That is the outcome of decisions made by UK politicians, to whom Article 50 gives the full control over the trigger. But we still need to think, what is the status and what are the costs and benefits for the UK and the EU of a very long period before Article 50 is triggered?
Just a short question. During the time in which we don't have this notification, the UK will be a member state at all effects. No, nothing changes.
No, I wanted to say, like, it seems really difficult to me to figure out the possibility of the so-called, like, guillotine. How is it possible that, like the relationship between UK and the European Union will interrupt, like, automatically? Like, what will happen? Like, what are the possible scenarios of it? Because, like, it seems really impossible to me to imagine what could happen, like, with such kind of, yeah.
I have a question, and it also elaborates a little bit on the first question by Oliver. I was actually wondering why Article 50 does not provide for any provision about the consequences for treaties or bilateral agreements or multilateral agreements which are actually between the EU and third countries or NGOs or other organizations. And that is actually what I'm missing in Article 50, also because it is that there is stated about the future between the member state, which, well, with Brexit and with the EU, but not about the consequences for all these other agreements. And then you must also distinguish between agreements fully by the EU or maybe mixed agreements. So what? Why does Article 50 not say anything about it?
I have a question about paragraphs 1 and 2 of the Article 50. From the European Union side, how should they think? Is the decision made? I mean, I'm reading, and any member state may decide. So is it decided? Because when I read this second paragraph, member state which decides to withdraw shall notify. So if a decision has been made, then isn't there an obligation for the government to, according what are saying the EU officials, that the UK should now proceed without delay?
Yes, I have questions concerning not so much Article 50, but the requirements of UK law on how to actually employ evoke Article 50. The referendum, as I understand, was not binding, of course. So who can actually go to the European Council and declare their will to withdraw? I assume it's the Prime Minister. And could Scotland or Northern Ireland or anyone else block it?
I think the so it's interesting that maybe trying to link this right back to the beginning, someone sort of plaintively suggested, why aren't there any substantive constraints upon member states leaving? And I think that would be just politically impossible in the context of the European Union, and it would allow a lot of people to say that that kind of backdrop sovereignty which states retain is actually lost if they can't actually secede from, withdraw from the European Union. But there may well be a middle ground which was missed in Article 50, which would have been some kind of uniform procedural requirement. So rather than saying that, you know, decide to withdraw in accordance with your own constitutional requirements, there could have been something there about the need for a referendum or some kind of thing which would have imposed some sort of uniform constraint. That might have achieved two objectives. The first objective is that it would have ensured that there was at least some procedural threshold which was crossed, which would be fairly uniform and presumably fairly high across the member states. It would also ensure that the problem that the penultimate speaker referred to would not arise, because it is certainly the case that if you read it in some way and you say that the UK has to specify when it has decided to withdraw, then what you then get is an imperative. It says shall. It shall invoke Article 50. So if we are to conclude that meeting the terms of the Advisory Referendum Act of 2015 was indeed the British constitutional requirement, then that really means that there should be no further delay until they invoke this. Now, no one's reading it that way for political reasons, and it's very hard to see how any of this could ever become justiciable. But I can see the reason for the procedural issue. Now, moving specifically on to somebody raised the Scottish question. From the beginning of the process, clearly there's a complicated backstory here, because there's this whole background of Scottish independence, etc., and the National Party, who received a significant mandate in the last election, saying that one of the changes in material circumstances under which they would contemplate having a second referendum in independence would be if the UK decided to withdraw from the EU, given that it was UK membership of the EU, which was the UK's trump card against Scottish independence only 2 years ago. Now, what they also said, they tried to make a kind of constitutional argument, which was that if each of the constituent parts of the United Kingdom did not independently vote for exit, vote for leave, then that would not constitute a proper vote for leave. Now, that argument has no legal basis. There's nothing in the Referendum Act which talks about requiring a majority in each of the constituent parts of the United Kingdom. Each of the constituent parts of the United Kingdom is invisible for these purposes. So if we are to take the measure of the internal constitutional requirement only to be the Referendum Act, then there's no case for saying that you need some special Scottish or Northern Irish permission in addition. At that point, though, it becomes about politics, right? And at that point, it becomes about, if we are to accept that actually Britain gets to decide politically when it wants to invoke Article 50, then presumably any British government is going to be somewhat hesitant about doing so, unless they can be sure that this is not going to automatically trigger a strong campaign for a further independence referendum within Scotland. So that remains, I mean, we can talk about that a little bit further if anyone wants to be, but that remains a significant political impediment to those people who wanted to leave the European Union because they were British nationalists. And if one of the consequences of that is that they break up the United Kingdom, then they cannot be happy with that.
Yeah, I mean, I'll come on to your point about the agreements, but just as a footnote to what Neil said, I mean, I think we should remember that the Act of Parliament, the Referendum Act, did not say anything about the consequences of the referendum. So it does not say. So I think for me it would be very difficult to read that as being simply the referendum on its own as being meeting the constitutional requirements, because I think you can then have an argument about whether this is a prerogative of the executive and the Prime Minister, or whether it requires a decision in Parliament, and that's a separate conversation. But I don't think it would be legally possible to argue that the Referendum Act itself was all the constitutional requirements, because it doesn't say anything about about the outcome of the referendum. I mean, it doesn't say there will be a decision to leave, you know. So on the agreements, so I think you have to think about, I think the reason why Article 50 doesn't deal with this, but at the same time it doesn't not deal with it, because it talks about the arrangements for its withdrawal, and so you could say that part of the arrangements for the withdrawal are thinking about how you handle the international agreements and the international relationship. So, but that's a sort of starting point. So then you have to think about what kinds of agreements there are. Agreements that have been entered into by the EU alone are binding on member states, but they're binding on member states by virtue of union law. So they're not binding on member states by virtue of international law. But as far as international law is concerned, it's the union that is the interlocutor and the bearer of the rights and responsibilities. So I think for EU-only agreements, if you like, it's an internal matter, and it's not a matter for international law, if you like. Mixed agreements, of course, are different. And I've been thinking about this. I think one way of looking at it would be to say, the withdrawing state, so the UK in this case, is a party to these mixed agreements as a sovereign state. And once the EU withdraws, it goes on being a party to the agreement. And one would merely say that those elements of the agreement which fall within union competence and which would in the past have been therefore governed by union responsibility with respect to that state, the state itself would now be the bearer of that responsibility and those obligations, right? In its own right, and it just goes on being a party. although the nature of the obligations which it has under the agreement might change. So that would be one way of looking at it. And I think for some mixed agreements, that's essentially how it would operate. If you take the big multilateral conventions, UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, the multilateral environmental conventions, you could see it that way. But I think there are other mixed agreements, and the EEA is one, actually, where you essentially you have the EU and its member states on the one part and a third country or a group of third countries on the other part. And it's quite hard to see how you would just shift the UK from being a party under one part to being a party under the other part without any kind of protocol handling that change. Because there are institutional, many of these agreements would be, for example, association agreements with association councils where you have to, you would have to have a membership issue, a representation issue on the institutions. So I think in terms of mixed agreements, one would have to, just as we do this in the opposite direction when new member states join, right? When new member states join, they have to, there has to be protocols to these mixed agreements, bringing the new member state, let's say Croatia most recently, into the EEA or whatever other mixed agreement we're talking about. Now that doesn't happen with the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. Croatia was a party, is still a party, but it's now a party and a member state of the EU. But with these more what you might call bilateral mixed agreements, there is always a protocol dealing with a new member state, and I think you'd have a protocol to deal with the removal of a member state as well. So, sorry, that was a bit of a long answer, but just giving you.
I think we'll probably need to move on to the. But I think the status of the referendum as advisory and now this gap. That has opened up in this temporal gap when Cameron did not just decide that when he delinked the referendum from the notification. It, of course, opened up a space to think, what did the referendum tell us? What was it saying? So there's an interpretative space. So you can say, well, the referendum told the UK government or parliament, whichever it ends up being, and that is currently in dispute, that the UK wants to leave, even if, as a non-member, it ends up applying all the EU law, or basically all the EU law it currently does. In other words, there is an independent value for those who voted to leave in having integration without membership. So that would be one interpretation. Another interpretation, which would be very different, would be we want to leave, provided the costs of doing so do not include breaking up the state that voted in the first place. So, so if the costs of leave are breaking up the UK, the constituent state, then maybe the referendum should not be pushed to that interpretation. Another interpretation, which would again have very different implications, is we want to leave unless our concerns on the free movement of persons are not addressed, which would again, all these interpretations are open. So the benefits of that are it creates a space for public discussion and opportunities. But of course, the costs are, although as you said a few minutes ago, the UK remains a full member, full obligations, full rights. People and businesses start to make decisions as though the UK is leaving and maybe factoring in the fullest possible Brexit options. So by the time the UK gets around to deciding what's it going to do, it's like closing the stable door after the horse has already bolted. You know, your banks have already moved and so on. So it's a very delicate environment at the moment. So I don't know if anyone else, Giorgio, did you want to say something? Okay. So I think that provides us with a good moment to move on to the next part of the discussion, which is exactly the UK at some stage does notify, and what might happen then. So there are two broad possible areas of investigation here. One is what options for the UK remaining as a full state entity as it currently does exist? So what sort of deal might it be able to make with the EU as a non-member? And the second set of issues are whether parts of the UK can remain in the EU. So especially the two parts of the UK, Scotland and Northern Ireland, that voted in a majority to remain in the EU. So I think Maurice is going to start us off on what options exist for the UK as a whole entity, as it currently exists, leaving.
Okay, just so try and be quick on this. So I think Article 50 presupposes, and this was touched on before, that there will be a future relationship. It presupposes that there will be some kind of relationship, but it doesn't say anything, of course, about what that should be or indeed how it should be negotiated. So we are in the realm then of, if you like, normal EU treaty relations. So the whole gamut of possible EU treaty relations is open. And it'll be a matter of political choice on both sides as to what is decided. So there's no track except for this implicit understanding that there will be some form of future relationship. But if it's decided on either side that there isn't any consensus over what that relationship might be, then there would be no. There would be no relationship governed by agreement, at any rate. So, that's one thing to say. So we're talking about assuming that we are talking about the negotiation of an agreement or a series of agreements, where we're then looking at the, if you like, at EU external relations. So, we're in the normal procedural provisions of Article 218 and the. Substantive external relations possibilities, which include various kinds of association agreement, trade agreements. So and there's a lot of flexibility there in legal terms. When talking about the options, people have generally put it in terms of, at one end of the spectrum, you would have an EEA or either actually joining the EEA or something very similar to the EEA on the one hand. You might have something that was more like, you know, the catchphrase that's being used for some reason at the moment is the Canada-style relationship, or we might consider something that was more along the Swiss type of relationship, which is a series of bilateral agreements. So the EEA, I mean, we talked a bit in the course about the EEA. The EEA option is just a few points to make about that. The EEA option, as we know, is it's a regulatory space, the EEA. So it has an emphasis on the regulatory and on not only regulatory convergence, but regulatory homogeneity. So it's a matter of adopting or continuing to apply the EU acquis in very large to a very large degree, but it is partial. It's not the whole of the EU acquis, and there are certain key areas which are not part of the EEA, and so that would have to be borne in mind. The common agricultural policy, fisheries, citizenship, foreign and external policy, including trade policy, defence, none of those are part of the EEA. Now, that doesn't mean that you couldn't build in those elements to a future relationship. And the EFTA states that are parties to the EEA have side agreements, if you like, which cover aspects of Schengen, even aspects of the area of freedom, security and justice, like the European arrest warrant and so on. So it would be possible to do that, although I think it would be difficult on the trade and defence side, but it would certainly be possible. And then one can say about the EA is that it has this element of dynamism, so it's not only about adopting the acquis, but keeping up with the acquis as it develops, and it has an institutional dimension. It implies being part of an external court system, and as you know, for the Leave campaigners, the European Court of Justice and the jurisdiction of the Court of Justice was one of the issues. So that's something that would have to be thought about. There's an EFTA surveillance authority. There's an EFTA court. So then we come on to how this might happen, how we might manage the transition. And this goes back to what I said earlier about the mixed agreements. I think you couldn't just say, well, the UK is a party to the EA anyway, so we can just do nothing and sit there and we'll continue to be a party to the EA and nothing will happen. I think there would have to be an amendment to the EA, which would presumably be by protocol, which would change the membership of the UK from being a member state of the EU to being an EFTA party. Now, an EFTA party, that means that before that happens, the UK should become party to the EFTA free trade agreement. I don't think it's absolutely essential, but it would be probably expected. Then you would have to have an agreement whereby the UK joined the EFTA or adjusted joined the EA or adjusted its membership of the EA as an EFTA member rather than as an EU member, and that would require the agreement of all other 27 plus the EFTA parties to the EEA. So it would have to go through ratification in the 27 plus 3 plus, of course, in the UK itself. So it would be a quite a substantial process. And then we have the possibility of if it's decided that that's too much, and of course free movement of persons, as we know, is a part of the EA, and I think it would be very difficult to envisage an EA without the free movement, but certainly not for one of the parties. So if that becomes a sticking point, then it looks like that option is not going to run. So then one would be looking at a looser kind of trade agreement, and it's not, I mean, one has to understand, and I'm sure you do understand, that a Canada-style trade agreement is not just an EA light, in other words, EA without the free movement of persons. It's a very different kind of agreement. It's not forming a regulatory space. It doesn't involve, it involves market access commitments, but it doesn't involve, it may involve some mutual recognition of regulation, but it's not a harmonized regulatory space, and that has implications for particularly for services, for example, and the degree of liberalization of services. So I think in a way the Canada agreement is the Canada agreement that's been negotiated is a kind of WTO plus. I mean, it's WTO with additional disciplines, with investment, with services, and so on, but with procurement, intellectual property, and some other areas. So it would look more; it would be more a WTO plus type of arrangement than it would be a substantial market integration in the kind of single market sense that we're used to thinking about it. I don't want to say very much about the Swiss option because I don't want to talk too long, but One point perhaps is that although the Swiss option is a series of bilateral agreements, the way that they were approached by the EU was to regard them as package deals. So you know that there is this current ongoing argument with the Swiss over the free movement of persons agreement, and the EU has always said that if Switzerland decides to pull out of the free movement of persons agreement, the other agreements in the package will fall as well. And there is a guillotine clause in the agreements, which basically says you have to be a party to all of them or they all fall. So for the EU, it was seen as really important that the agreements worked together as a package. So we can't necessarily assume that the EU would be able to agree a kind of Swiss option that was several agreements but not free movement of persons. I mean, I'm not saying it couldn't. It's a political decision. But the Swiss model is not like that. It's very much linking the bilaterals together. I think that's all I wanted to say.
Maybe we can take any questions or thoughts or comments people have on those UK stays as one entity as it currently is, but gets a different status with the EU. Has anyone got any thoughts or comments on questions on those different options?
So it's a question that's linked to what the deal afterwards would be, but also looking in Article 50 at the role of the European Parliament in having to consent to a withdrawal agreement or a future relations agreement. And even though I think we understand from the experience of the intergovernmental conferences, this isn't a veto power, I wonder if it would give a lot of scope for members of the European Parliament to try and enter into dialogue to ensure that the best deal is obtained for their constituents. Because it seems to be an aspect that's been underplayed in all of this.
Perhaps just to make clear that Article 50 only talks about the withdrawal agreement. Yeah. So the question of the future agreement, which is what we're now discussing, the role of the Parliament depends on what legal basis is chosen. But any likely legal basis would also include the consent of the European Parliament, but it's not derived from Article 50. So if it was an association, that requires consent of the European Parliament. Trade agreement used not to, but does now, post-Lisbon. So it's hard to imagine an agreement that being negotiated, except an agreement only on the CFSP, which I suppose would be a possible scenario, which would not require the consent of the European Parliament. So I agree, and I think the Parliament would clearly have something to say about such an agreement, as would the... something else I didn't say to mention very briefly is that this agreement would be very likely, unlike the withdrawal agreement, to be a mixed agreement. So I talked about that in relation to the EA, but that would actually be also very likely to be true. It's not a coincidence, for example, that Juncker and the Commission have given way to pressure for member states that the Canada agreement, the CETA, should now be a mixed agreement. So TTIP, very, very likely to be a mixed agreement, if it ever happens, which seems increasingly unlikely, but would be a mixed agreement as well, I think, almost certainly. So I think it would be a mixed agreement, which means any agreement would require the Parliament and all the other member states to ratify, which in some cases means multiple procedures for those member states that have... that have to have consent of different communities like Belgium.
Yes, many thanks for the presentation. I have one problem to understand what the UK means when, or the Alt campaign means when they say we want to have access to the internal market but not free movement. Because first of all, you said it's a dynamic regulatory space. So is it the internal market as today or in 10 years? And does, for instance, competition law apply, state aid law? Which freedoms, so for instance, free movement of services has also a personal free movement of persons aspect in certain cases. So is there any idea about this in the debate?
Very little idea. I mean, in the sense that it's cloud cuckoo land to think that there would ever be an agreement on access to the internal market without some element of... I mean, the internal market is the four freedoms. So by definition, if you refuse free movement of persons, you are not talking about the internal market or the single market. You're talking about something different. Now, that doesn't mean that the EU might not politically decide that it was going to agree to an agreement that gave free movement of goods and services and establishment without people. It could do that. Of course it could do that. Politically, it seems very unlikely. But we wouldn't then be talking about an extension of the single market or participation in the single market. I mean, maybe that's playing with words, but I think it, you know, that's worth saying. We'd be talking about a different kind of deal which would be, in the class we looked at the Ukraine agreement. The Ukraine agreement doesn't have free movement of persons, and it does have some liberalisation of services, but it contains the dynamism and the homogeneity in the areas in which it covers, but not in other areas. So it's not that these things are impossible, but it's just a question of what the EU is likely to agree to and the political statements that it's making at the moment.
Oh, thank you for the presentation. Much of the commentary that I've read has focused on what sort of agreement or negotiations or relationship the UK would want with the EU. The EU's kept its powder somewhat dry and is probably waiting for the UK to make the first move, but I'm wondering what relationship do you think the EU wants with the UK now, of the amongst the options that you've outlined thus far? Thank you.
Okay. Well, I had a question stroke comment which actually builds on from that, because one thing to think about is you've given a lot of examples of EU agreements with others. But is that the domain? If you look at the WTO website, there are 270 trade agreements, of which only about 40 the EU is a member to. That is to say, there are a lot of other international agreements that we can look at. Mercosur, ASEAN, have a lot of interesting modalities by which member states can cooperate with amongst each other in the Union. So I think the box of options is much wider than we think. But then the question is, from the EU's perspective, following on from that question, is the box as wide as that? Or does the EU want to kind of block the UK into one of the existing boxes, because otherwise it's seen to be doing a special favor? But the other thing is, and this is why, just reflecting on your talk this morning, you know, the EU is a nice experiment, but it's no longer the only supranational agency that tries to coordinate independent states. I mean, if you look at some cooperations in Mercosur about does one member state really want to implement that law or not, there are different modalities by which that is discussed. So I think it would open a nice space for discussion about how a state is integrated. The other question is, can you have an out-in-in? That is to say, you have a framework agreement for the next 5 years, which says, okay, for the next 5 years, the relationship between the UK and the EU is X, but within those 5 years, then we negotiate the more complete agreement of relations between them. That might be more feasible rather than having a single agreement, because if you look at it, that might be an option. The other thing is, I mean, shouldn't the framework for future relations be agreed before the notification of withdrawal is made, if you read paragraph 2 of Article 50 literally? But
I have also a question, because what actually after, what are the, what will the connections be with the EU and the UK? Most of the time we talked about the internal market, but I was also wondering what are the consequences for cases before the Court of Justice, which are hanging now, and also with at competition law, whether there is now for the Commission a leniency application or something like that, but what are the consequences for that? I think that we also have to take that into account.
I just briefly to Georgia's comment, I agree completely that I wasn't trying to say that these were the only options. It's more that they're models of relationship. I mean, the EA is sometimes talked about because it's seen as a kind of off-the-peg solution, which is almost membership but not quite, and therefore might be quite attractive. But of course, what I was meaning when I said we're into the realm of EU external relations and there are all sorts of options, it's entirely open. I mean, there is the possibility of entering into an association agreement, but the treaty says nothing about what an association agreement has to be. So absolutely anything is possible. It's just a question of the political will on both sides. So it is very open on the one hand. On the other, and so when I talk about Canada and Switzerland, it was purely, these are a shorthand for certain models that might work, but there are other models. And I think But having said that, I would also say, and I don't think it's about punishing or constraining, or it's not about that. The EU has had a tendency in the past, but this may be regarded as a special case and therefore previous practice isn't necessarily a guidance, to want to structure relationships with third countries along certain familiar lines. So it tends to have package deals that it takes off the shelf. And that's partly, of course, because it doesn't have an infinite number of trade negotiators. So, you know, it basically they say, do we want this model or do we want that model or do we want this model? It's normal that that's how it works. So it there is a tendency to think about relationships in terms of previous models.
Yeah. So when Georgia was speaking, I suddenly had this image of Britain joining Mercosur. You know, so maybe that was Nigel Farage's deep plan. But I think there's a serious point there, and it comes back to something that's been said, which is that, I mean, the Leave campaign's strategy was not to look for more complexity; it was less complexity. You know, and Boris Johnson's famously said, "You can have your cake and eat it. You can have exactly what you want, you know, without freedom of movement, etc." Which is palpably untrue. So maybe the UK will learn the hard way that there are other options which are more complex. They may learn creatively from elsewhere, but I think there's a genuine problem there. There's also a resource problem. I mean, Nigel Farage, within the last couple of days, when he was put to him that Britain lacked the trade negotiators, as he said, "Well, Europe has plenty; it can borrow some from Europe." So that's the level of seriousness we have within this debate. You know, on the point of it's a good question: what does the EU want out of this? And of course, The question is there is no. It's back to the what I called this morning the acephalous political structure. There is no EU. There's no obvious EU voice here. There are the attitudes of the original six are maybe different from the attitudes of some of Britain's friends in Central Europe. The attitude of the Commission and the Council seems to be different from the attitude of Merkel. There will come a point where some of these things will be resolved, but even when they're resolved, they'll just be resolved into a negotiating position, because presumably the EU is caught in a cleft stick here between clearly wanting a situation where the actual withdrawal of the UK is not something which encourages others to do the same, but at the same token, not destroying the basis of a relationship with an important partner, and also perhaps leaving the option of these things being resolved before the Article 50 process is finalised. In fact, I think one of the things that Giorgio suggested there is interesting. I was thinking about this probation period of 5 years. If you had a probation period of 5 years and you go back to Article 55, which talks about the possibility of rejoining, one of the first things that Juncker said after the vote is Britain could rejoin again one day, which seems a really quite unfeasible thing to say in that context. But if you think of it in terms of a situation where, what was it you called it, Giorgio, an in-in-out? Complicated. But you can imagine that the extent and degree of the withdrawal would not have been so significant that the possibility of coming back in again might not be impossible. But that's all speculation.
Linking up with that, I think one of the weaknesses of the more advanced models of cooperation is that the third countries do not participate in EU decision-making. So that's something that they all resent. And Norway, for example, has said to the UK, I don't wish our position on you, because we have to follow whatever internal market legislation is decided by the EU. We have no voice, basically. We can sit there, but we don't vote. And we have to accept whatever is decided. So if the UK is interested in continuing to participate in internal market law and in the evolution of internal market law in the future, it would find itself in this very uncomfortable position. And a small country like Norway might accept it, but the UK, I would find it difficult for the UK to accept to be a passive receiver of legislation made in Brussels. That's clearly much worse than what they have now. Yeah. And if that is an option, then one could wonder whether the UK would not indeed consider that remaining inside the European Union, but with many more opt-outs than they have now, might be much more advantageous than to be outside and to have to follow what the EU decides. So that would, again, possibly lead towards non-withdrawal in the end. But that's again a rational consideration, and I don't know whether this is going to happen.
Just to add to the options, I hear that the African Union was opening its arms to the UK as well. But apart from the joke, I just wanted to ask a question. In light of the fact that once the Article 50 is triggered, as the negotiations may take years before the release, and it's the article establishes that it may remain, the UK may remain in the EU during this time and may be extended as well. In paragraph 4, I think it says that the withdrawing member state shall not participate in the discussions of the European Council or Council or in decisions concerning the withdrawing state. Here, considering the Brussels effect, it may mean that it may be excluded from any discussions. But as it will remain as within the EU, and it has been a very active member in particular in the financial policy of the EU. What would be the what would be the role of the EU then in the Council, in the Parliament as well, as it is heading outside, but it may still be interested in a way to influence some policies of the EU. But on the other hand, the European leaders have already held one of the meetings without Cameron. What would it be like in the future? I mean, this is also my question to you.
Can I answer one specific bit of that question, which is actually, I was thinking about it in terms of banking union. The UK will remain, if it exits, a member of a number of the international standard setting bodies. So although it's out of ESA, the European Supervisory Authorities networks, it's still in the Basel 3-4 conventions. So it can still voice there. And what, I mean, if there is a clean exit, then what you would imagine would be that the EU negotiators would take the UK's views into account through these international standard setting bodies, notwithstanding the fact that they're no longer members of the European Union. Because, you know, if the next step in banking union is the capital markets union, you cannot have a capital markets union in the EU without the UK. I mean, the UK is where most of the capital markets are. So on the one hand, you could say, long enough. There is some speculation as to how long London remains as a center, but, you know, there are supranational bodies that are above the EU where I think a lot of the negotiations can take place. So I think that might be the fora for a lot of trade-related issues, that the EU is a player within a broader context. Of course, you can say that, you know, if you look at the banking regulations that we have now, the UK had a significant impact in the way in which the MiFID was drafted, for example. Okay, so that will probably decrease, but maybe not decrease so much if the international fora becomes more important than the EU lawmaking forum.
Just one issue. I mean, you seem to imply that it may take years. I think you were talking about the withdrawal, and my point would be clear, according to Article 50, it wouldn't take years. It will only take years if there is no single member state that vetoes the extension beyond the 2 years. Otherwise, once it's been there's been an application to withdraw, it will take 2 years and then it will be done, unless there is an agreement to withdraw the withdrawal application. So the real crux, in a sense, is the framework for its future relationship with the Union. And you seem to suggest, Giorgio, that reading literally paragraph 2, that should be worked out first before the other is triggered, if I followed you correctly. Yeah. But in any event, I mean, politically that also makes sense, but one element that hasn't been mentioned up until now, I'm not sure about that, I think you can read the wording differently. But in any event, as Marie's pointed out, the framework for future relationship will follow 218, and that also involves not just the 27 member states plus the UK, but also importantly the European Parliament. That ever, you know, Article 218, paragraph 10 also says that it has to be, the European Parliament has to be immediately and fully informed also of the negotiations, so implies a more active role also for the European Parliament during the negotiation. And also, at the very end, a member state or institutions or the European Parliament can refer to the court to find out if it's compatible. So just in terms of how long this may take, I think those are also additional factors that need to be factored in.
Well, it's not like more as a general remark. I just wanted to personally say that I find that the discussion on Article 50 is not new. In fact, since 2009, the sovereign debt crisis had sparked a lot of debate, especially in the context of the EMU, on the right of withdrawal or expulsion from the EU. It was decided that no action would be taken at that stage, of course. So I would think that Article 50 and its modalities or amendment of the treaties thereof, it's something that will not happen today either.
Thank you very much. I have a bit of an impossible question, which is like, I'm still in those five stages of grief, according to Elizabeth Kubler-Ross on the Brexit. So I'm desperately trying to find the silver lining of the whole discussion to end with a bit more positive note, maybe. I think we already discussed that the UK has a special role in European politics. It always was a bit of a contra party in that. We already discussed maybe it could strengthen the European Parliament. So is there any silver lining on the horizon for European politics or European law after the Brexit, when Britain would leave or Britain is leaving? There was just today, there was a new statistic in Germany that the preference for the European Union now raised increasingly. So the Germans love the Brexit in some ways or the other. So maybe it will have a positive impact on democratic legitimacy. I don't know, I invite for speculation.
Yeah, my point was quite close to her, actually. I mean, just according to some opinions, actually, I heard many people saying that leaving for not having UK in the European Union actually is not such a bad thing. I mean, I don't want to offend anyone. Of course, I can understand that it's just an opinion, because actually UK a lot of times was the protagonist or the main character of some opt-out decision. I mean, UK has always had his own money, his own kind of veto in many situations. So some opinions say, okay, well, we don't have UK, we finally can achieve the big state of Europe, finally. I don't know. That's just a point.
I have a relevant question about this topic. In which ways will the Brexit affect the European integration? Will it lead to a stronger European integration and a closer union in terms of fiscal policy or banking union? Or will it lead to an increasement of differentiation in Europe? And how will this affect the negotiation? Would it be possible to see a second referendum after a negotiation?
We've got 3 minutes left until the official closing time, but maybe we can go on for a little bit longer than the projected time. So just to put all the issues remaining, I can't even use these words anymore, on the table, let's take control of the debate. Anyway, So there, I'm taking control. If anyone wants to vote leave, you've got the. So there are three sets of issues that we've still got to cover. So I'm going to put them all on the table and then we can have interventions and discussion on any of those issues. So the first that have come up in the questions is it good for the EU if the UK leaves? How might that change the EU? And already we see signs that they think, well, we shouldn't feed these populists any longer. Maybe austerity was not such a good idea. So a lot more discussion of social market economy and so on over the last days, which I think is really interesting. So that's one set of issues on which people may have views and points. A second issue is it still possible for the UK to have a new status as a member? So here there are just three brief elements to mention. One is look again carefully at the agreement made on the 18th and 19th of February 2016, and you will see it's quite ambiguous what the current status of that agreement is. So you know the one where they got the safeguard, the in-work benefits, all the other things. Is that agreement still on the table if the UK goes to the EU and says, we have decided we want to remain as a member and take advantage of that agreement? And look at the conclusions of the European Council and you will see there are ambiguous statements as to what happens to that agreement in the event of the referendum. It is not clear what the status of that agreement is. We can talk about that. A second possibility, which Bruno has recently written about in a short editorial for the European Law Review, I hope he doesn't mind me. He can elaborate or correct me, where he says, well, why don't we offer the UK something called partial membership, which essentially would be a codification of their current opt-outs, perhaps adding in the agreement if it's still in force. So give it, make clear what is already clear, as you said already, it's out of loads of things. So why don't we codify that and then that can be sold as a different kind of membership, a new status of membership. A third element that might be put in there, just to float this, is that you know the UK was the only member state apart from Sweden that did not use the transitional restrictions on free movement of persons. So in 2004, although it did use them for Bulgaria, Romania, and Croatia. So a question is whether as part of a deal to give the UK 7 years breathing space and to respond to some of the issues that came up in the referendum, could those transitional restrictions be offered to the UK as part of a deal? So that is remaining. What kind of status, what sort of deal could be done? The other issue we haven't discussed, which we may wish to discuss, is can parts of the UK remain in the EU? So here there are two different options to think about, and then people can contribute on those. The first is the UK remains as a member state, but parts of the UK, England and Wales, exit the EU. So this would be a kind of devolved membership with potentially UK central government keeping common foreign and security policy if they wanted, and then devolved membership for Scotland and Northern Ireland. Is that possible? So this is like the Greenland scenario, but in a very different set of circumstances. The second option is Northern Ireland and Scotland exit the UK and remain in the EU. And here I think for Scotland, this would be most likely through Scotland becoming an independent member state. And for Northern Ireland, because of the conditions of the Good Friday Agreement of 1998, it would be by triggering a border pull, as that agreement provides, in which Northern Ireland would have to decide whether they would prefer to join Ireland than leave the EU. So those seem to me the main options on the table. So there I open it for debate for any other panel members. I think Neil might say something about Scotland.
Yeah, I mean, I guess we're running out of time, so I'll keep it quick. I mean, I think what's called the, for me, sorry, the reverse Greenland option does not seem plausible. I mean, the Greenland option was about Denmark, a continuing member, a continuing sovereign state, some part of its territory already quite autonomous, even in terms of domestic constitutional law, decides it doesn't want to be part of the EU framework anymore. That doesn't disturb the relationship between the sovereign state and the member state of Denmark and the EU. An inverse Greenland, it seems, does, you know. And now, Nicola Sturgeon, the Scottish First Minister, has been very, very assiduous in trying to pursue the possibility of Scotland, Northern Ireland, London, Gibraltar. She's been to Gibraltar as well. You know, somehow providing some sort of common, perhaps the EUI, I don't know. common framework for staying in while other parts leave. I just don't see how that can possibly work. You know, presumably, you know, at the end of the day, you know, the UK remains the member state. The UK politically wants to leave, is choosing to leave. I can't imagine any internal constitutional scenario where 90% of the UK becomes somehow the insignificant part, you know, which somehow leaves, whereas 10% stays in. And I thought that everything we understand about the discipline of the EU and the fact that it's for the member state to take responsibility for meeting the obligations of the state means that a part of the state can't possibly continue when the state itself carries on. I can't see how, alternatively, although others who know more about international law may disagree, how Scotland can be treated as a continuing state in these circumstances, where it has less than 10% of the population, less than 10% of the GTB, etc., etc. So I don't see any plausible scenario whereby the inverse Greenland situation works. And I don't think actually anyone does. I think what the Scottish Nationalists are doing is that they're making sure that they do due diligence, so to speak, on the possibilities of not using the nuclear option of another independence referendum in order to try to stay in on some sort of basis. The other thing they're trying to do, of course, is just to show how much they want to be members, therefore hoping that somehow the withdrawal process could somehow take place in parallel with an Article 49, or not in parallel with, but at least in some sort of diplomatic parallel with an Article 49 procedure from a newly independent Scotland. But that's all very, very difficult. And of course, the independence of Scotland would depend upon another internal referendum, the timing of which would not be within the gift of the Scottish Parliament, etc., etc. So again, it's hard to see how an independent Scotland gets anywhere near the European Union until the whole Article 50 process is finalised, despite their best intentions and most fervent wishes. And everything I say about Scotland is compounded in difficulty by Northern Ireland.
I'd like to reply to one specific question which was put here, is the parallel with Greece, basically, no? Brexit, the Brexit discussion. I think it's not a precedent. It's entirely different, because Greece never wanted to leave either the European Union or the Eurozone. So, and that makes it entirely different. And indeed, in that situation, if the country doesn't want to leave, we don't have rules on expulsion of any kind. And there you could argue that there is no possibility to expel a member state. Here we are in a very different scenario, where the country itself probably decides to withdraw, and there's nothing to stop it from doing it according to Article 50. So I don't think Greece is a precedent on this. And the fact that Greece has stayed in is not a reassurance that also the UK will also stay in. I don't think so.
I have a theoretical question regarding the British law. As far as I know, the decision of the Vox Populi is not obligatory to the parliament. So what if the British politicians see themselves in the future as a passive player in the negotiations regarding the single market and economic questions, and they decide that they stay in the EU? And they say thank you for the opinion of the citizens, but but they see that it's more advantageous to stay in the EU. Is it possible? What do you think?
It's strictly connected. I see a link with the Greek case, particularly on this regard, because what happened in Greece, it was what could happen if UK decides, I mean, if British politicians decide to remain, because it was a referendum saying something, which now is to leave, and then it was something different, obviously. It was not to accept European agreement about Greece, and politicians and with the agreement of EU politicians decided to disattend what people voted for. So that could be, that's why Greece could be a precedent, only on this extent, obviously.
So we're going to just stay for a couple more minutes, and then we're going to wrap it up and let you go enjoy the weekend. So I think, of course, this is very enjoyable, but you might have other things to do outside Salou Europa, where you've spent a lot of hours this week already. So I think what we'd like to do is take up the challenge a number of people raised and ask about what are the challenges and opportunities this decision or referendum in the UK presents for the EU. And we will just go along the panel. I mean, I've already said, I think, what I wanted to say, that I see this interesting shift towards social market economy and connecting austerity with Brexit. And that may, for me, be a kind of a good opportunity coming out of these difficult circumstances. So I'll just invite the rest of the panel, if they want to reflect on the challenges and opportunities for the EU in light of this decision, that the effects of which are unfolding. So do you want to start?
Something quickly. I mean, just, I think a couple of, well, a lot of people have said, apart from the social market economy opportunities, there's also just a sense that as people have begun to see what's happening in the UK, they begin to see the dangers. I mean, the Remain campaign in the UK were criticised as pursuing what was called Project Fear. Unfortunately, Project Fear didn't work in the UK, but perhaps it's working in the rest of the EU as people begin to see some of the consequences. So in that sense, there's something salutary about the British experience. I remain ambivalent about how positively salutary something which actually makes people scared can actually be, but that shouldn't be taken account of. One thing, though, to bear in mind, though, is that the Visegrad states, Poland and Hungary and the Czech Republic and Slovakia, they've had a different attitude, you know, to the British exit, the possibility of a British exit. They seem more dismayed than others by that, because they saw the UK very much as an alibi amongst the group of states which were perhaps somewhat more Eurosceptical. And in that sense, I think there is the way in which we, there might be more fear there about the possibility of a differentiated integration model. In some way, Britain was a stable element within the differentiated integration of the European Union, because despite being an outlier in terms of opt-outs, et cetera, and it made it a very, very powerful party, and therefore gave some succor to other parties which were also to some extent opted out from some aspects of it. So I think that balance has been disturbed. So there are negative features as well as positive features. And also I would say it's very, very early days. It is extremely early days. None of us can predict the fallout. One of my immediate fears was when we looked at these statistics which suggested that 48% of Italians and 41% of French, if there was a British no vote, would also want a referendum and would want to vote no, which was like the real terrible dystopian domino effect. I don't think anyone's saying that now, but that was a genuine representation of opinion only 6 weeks ago. It's not gone away entirely. So we shouldn't be, you know, we shouldn't be too complacent that somehow the domino effect fear has been laid to one side.
Just it sort of picks up on that really, and I don't want to sound complacent, but I think there's another aspect of the project fear thing. I don't think it's just that people look at the UK and say we don't want to go there. It's also that I think it has made people articulate why they actually care about being a member, and particularly individuals. So it in the UK, but also in the rest of Europe. So there is a positive side of that, I think. And I agree with Neil that this is early days and things may shift again. But there is a dimension there of people beginning to see what they, or to articulate perhaps more what they value about the European Union. So that's one thing. And I think, again, it's picking up on what you were saying. There is a sense in which you have these kind of catalytic moments where things are destabilized. And I think quite a lot depends. Unfortunately, I don't have a great expectation that the UK negotiation with the EU will be very sure-footed or nuanced. But if it were to be, if it were clever and if it were sure-footed, then I think we might see a discussion taking place which is not just about the relationship of the UK with the EU, but also perhaps some catalytic effect on rethinking the degree of centralization, decentralization, differentiation within the EU itself. So it might, if it's done well, but much less likely if it's done badly, create a positive, creative thinking about how we handle a union of 27 or 27 plus one or whatever, whereby the UK is not seen just as an outlier, but as an opportunity to rethink what membership might mean. So that's sort of putting a positive spin on it, playing the glad game, if you like.
Continuing actually on what you've just said, Maurice, and coming back to this idea of Bruno's, of partial membership, there is an opportunity there, I think, for the 27 also in September, Bratislava, to think about the nature of membership in the European Union and the fact that there can possibly be partial membership, but so more broadly than the UK. The issue with that is then you will have other member states, I think, such as Denmark, who for me would be the most obvious example and the first to come to mind, who also want that. So I think they have to think very carefully. On the other hand, if the UK, if it's an exclusively UK deal, in a sense, they can be seen as having won, in a certain sense, the Leave campaign by they then get what they want, is a sort of opt-in maybe to something and much further going arrangements with regard to free movement than they got in the original agreement. So there is a danger in that I think the other 27 will have to be aware of. And certainly, in terms of, if I look in the Netherlands, for example, the Netherlands was one of the original six, has always been a sort of advocate of federal Europe, small member state, a believer in the power of supranationalism, also to protect their own national interests. But in recent years, has not at all been pro integration under the existing government. And so we see a switch, I feel, now, not only among individuals, which you see in opinion polls, but also in governments. I mean, I see the Prime Minister, Rutte, who is now sort of a fervent, coming out fervently in favor of the value of European integration. So I think that has a part, you know, that it's making also the politicians express the value in a positive way. So some good may come out of that as well, as they recognize the need to do something about some of the deficits also in governance terms and democratic terms about the way decisions are taken in the European Union. So that can ultimately also have a more positive effect.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, just a couple of thoughts. One, this vision of the UK as the outlier, of course it depends which room you're sitting. So if you sit in the European Competition Network or in the network of European telecommunications, everybody listens to the UK. They want to learn. The UK has been a leader in a number of regulatory fields, and without the UK, you really wonder how the European Commission is going to drive forward some of its major economic policies. So I think you need to, the UK as an outlier is nice for the front page of the newspapers, but you open the second and third pages and you say the UK is a fundamentally vital player in the economic success of the bits of Europe that do work. Sorry, this is not being optimistic at all. The second point, I think it's important to, yes, the feedback is we value the EU, but we also do not value the EU. So this is a nice opportunity for deciding what we don't want from the EU. In fact, what would be really interesting would be real Brexit. Because then what would happen would be that somehow the UK would have to decide which of the many, many laws that we've enacted we don't like. And then the UK would have a procedure whereby they would have to decide, okay, which bits of EU law that we've transplanted voluntarily, involuntarily, deliberately, we actually do not like. And if that process of debate comes up, then that creates a nice framework for at least to see in one member state what it is that the citizens do not like. So you could have Damien Chalmers wrote about this. He said, let's have a citizens' action. So here are the 2,000 pieces of legislation we could revise. Which sections of which act do you not like? And then if enough people say, we don't like that one, then that tells you something about what it is people do not like about the EU. I mean, it would be a, some other colleagues are saying this is a nightmare, but if there is clean Brexit, then you've got to decide what you want to keep and what you don't. And that might create an interesting space for a debate about what it is that the excluded people don't like.
The balance of competence review decided that they actually liked it all. And there was virtually nothing that they didn't want.
So, thanks to everyone very much for coming along on this hot Friday afternoon, and I hope you leave feeling hopeful somehow or other, and have a great weekend.